Hello and welcome to 9 Months, India's first and only comprehensive show on pregnancy and parenting. In the first season, we took you through all the joys and worries of being pregnant. And in this season, we're going to bring you all the joys and worries of the most important and interesting phase of your life, that is parenting. All your worries, all your joys, all your questions, and everything that's best for your baby and your family. The first 3 to 6 months are a very interesting phase for a new mother. While she's still suffering from sleep deprivation, she's also experiencing the joys that come with watching her newborn officially become an infant. To talk to us about the second trimester of motherhood, I'm joined by two renowned experts, Dr. Nihar Parekh and Bina Chheda. Thank you so much for joining us here today.
Pleasure.
You know, there's another thing that's always divided a lot of opinions, that is breastfeeding. So how long do you think a mother should continue breastfeeding? The WHO, for example, recommends almost 2 years.
Every mother should have is exclusive breastfeeding till 6 months.
Okay.
Do not introduce.
Unless it's not possible for her because of other reasons.
For any medical reason or anything, that's a different issue.
Okay.
But till 6 months, exclusive breastfeeding.
Okay.
Okay, and then it can continue. Continue up to 2 years. Some people even continue up to 3-4 years. But that is just leading to unnecessary latching on of the child to the mother. It's not giving any nutrition.
Okay.
Yeah, because the baby has already started eating. Okay.
So that's just a comfort factor.
Yes, exactly.
That can give sleepless nights to the mothers
because
it can be very addicting.
Of course.
So technically, basically, like she rightly said, try and feed exclusively till 6 months.
Yeah.
If reasons otherwise. Start the weaning diet at 5.5-6 months. Breastfeeding can continue up to 1.5 to 2 years. But post 1 year, as pediatricians, we recommend to stop the breastfeeding in the middle of the night.
Okay.
Because it eats in during the appetite of the day. So if the passive feeding continues in the night while sleeping post 1 year of age, they don't eat through the day because their stomach's already full. So the adequate nutrition, what they should get now from food, doesn't come.
Okay. You know, there's so many contrarian advice that is available. So for me personally, I just trust my own way. I follow my instinct. I follow my gut. Because if you breastfeed, don't breastfeed. If you give formula, don't give formula. For how long? I think there's always somebody who will give you contrarian advice.
Look at the
child. Exactly.
Whether the child is growing well.
Exactly.
You know, the overall look of the baby, happy, smiley baby. We'll come to know from that itself.
For me, one of the biggest concerns of introducing water to the baby is the fact that the water is not always very safe, right? At least in India, there's so many concerns that even if you boil the water for, say, 20, 30 minutes, the fact that it's still contaminated, it has pollutants, it has arsenic, it has lead, it has rust from the water pipes. And if you boil it too much, then it'll lose the essential minerals. So it's such a toss-up then, you know, what to do with feeding the baby a little bit of water, giving the baby a little bit of water. Do you think water purifiers or any other sources would help in this case?
So basically, like we emphasized before, there's enough water going to the baby. You don't need to give that extra water.
Okay.
But if you want to, usually a few teaspoons after a weaning diet to rinse the mouth, you can. And whatever water you use to make your weaning diet, irrespective of whether you use a purifier, which we strongly recommend you do, even there is rust, there's arsenic, you know, dying of the minerals, there's enough other sources going as minerals for your child. You're giving your weaning diet, which has your calcium and magnesium, what you're worried about, the fruits, your breast milk. Certain supplementations are given to the baby. I'm sure you must be on them already. The calcium, the vitamin D. So we're not worried about that.
Okay.
But like, hygiene is extremely important. You want to make sure you don't shift water from a clean utensil to a dirty utensil.
Right. Now, you know, in today's world, children, even newborn babies, are suffering from a lot of respiratory ailments and diseases because of the outdoor pollution, whether it's in metros like Delhi or Bombay, even smaller towns and cities. And the worst part is that the indoor pollution is 10 times worse than what we see outdoors because of disinfectants and detergents and pollutants in the air, pesticides, we've got dust in the house, paint, smoke smells, you know, there's just so many trigger factors. If you've got animals, you've got, you know, if you've got pets, you've got animal dander. So there's so many trigger points for that. So how do you protect a newborn baby's respiratory tract that's just opening up to ensure that your baby doesn't get exposed to asthma or allergies and keep the air sort of clear of all allergens?
The newborn has to be fed the colostrum which comes out, okay?
From the breast milk.
Yes, the first feed, okay? That's important. Then exclusive 6 months ka breastfeeding, will never make the baby prone to infections or anything.
Okay.
There are certain reasons why if the top feeds are introduced very fast, these respiratory diseases tend to set in faster.
Okay.
Some heredity factors also playing up a role, but not if exclusively breastfed.
Okay.
So breastfeeding should be emphasized exclusively for the 6 months. How much ever, 10,000 times also, if you tell exclusive breastfeeding, if you have to repeat that thing, do not hesitate.
Okay. Okay. What other methods can be used?
Well, you're bringing up your child in an environment nowadays which is getting worse by the day.
Exactly.
So you have, even if it's not, I mean, you hear about new diseases every year.
Hmm.
The number of vaccines are not going lesser. They're just increasing. So just kind of, it's a global situation, more so in the urban than in the rural areas. But rural areas are not excluded. The thing is, A, immunity. So you got to make your child stronger from inside. And like Bina said rightly, breastfeeding is the key.
Okay.
Second, you have to remember the kind of exposure you give your child. You want to keep the air as clean as possible. But you don't want to lock him up in a cage.
Okay.
Not in a glass cylinder.
Yeah.
You need him to build, or her, to build his own or her immunity.
Yeah.
So that she grows up to fight stronger, better diseases on her own later. Vaccines to prevent against communicable diseases.
Okay.
Your pneumonia vaccines, your rotaviral vaccines, all these are vaccines which are not given on standard basis, but we cannot emphasize more on how important they are with the growing pollution in the air and around.
Okay.
Number
okay.
one. Number two, keeping the air as clean as possible. So there are certain very strict no-noses, you know, which can actually trigger coughs in kids of this age. One is the smell. Second is the air pollutants, like your sprays and close-by deodorants and perfumes.
Right.
Smokers in the house,
yes.
Big problem,
of
huge
course.
Problem.
Yeah.
So passive smoking, they can really harm the child. Deionizers, air purifiers, play a very big role here. Humidifiers, dehumidifiers don't work. But these do help in cleaning the air.
So if you should preferably get an air purifier, one of those, so
yes.
to make sure that at least the indoor environment,
exactly.
the room where the baby sleeps,
yes.
or your house,
yes.
is at least, you know, you're
yeah.
protecting the
yeah.
baby.
So you keep those
extent.
Things away, you clean the existing air, you
yeah.
ventilate the room twice a day.
Okay.
Open the window morning, evening, get some fresh air. Don't just, you know, kind of
coop
pack
up
them
the
up.
Baby. Yeah.
And lastly, keep them away from evidently sick people. You know, there's
of
a
course.
Habit if someone comes home, they don't hesitate before
yeah.
touching the child with their same hand which is used to cover their mouth and nose when they're
yes.
coughing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So certain hygiene principles you really have to be a little strict on.
Okay.
But at the end of the day, you have to let the baby grow. You know, like I said, even if you grow the baby in the city of Bombay in a glass cylinder, they're still going to get diseases.
Yes, yes.
So you do your best. I mean, you have your helping doctors at hand.
Yes.
You have your prevention protocols in the form of vaccines, breastfeeding like Bina mentioned.
Mm.
You do the best you can, but
of
then
course.
Let the city bring up the child, because this is where she or he is going to grow up.
Definitely. I think ultimately it's your way is the best way, right? There's
Absolutely.
Not really any way
Absolutely.
Around that.
Yeah.
But if it's different weather conditions, like suppose you're living, like in Bombay, of course,
sure.
Mumbai, we don't have
yeah.
seasons per se, except
right.
for monsoon. But if you're living, say, in Delhi or colder places, which actually have seasons,
right.
how do you then keep up, you know, the air purity for your child?
So every season comes with its own particular problem. Like in Bombay, we have the rains.
Right.
And the gastros are huge, stomach
mm.
infection. But in as you go up north, where it's colder, the
mm.
Decembers and the Jans, your winters, there are thick, smoggy air, which we did suffer from in Bombay
of course,
as well. Yeah.
Yes.
So these are times when the kids are maximum and most prone to respiratory tract infection. So again, deionizers, keeping
yeah.
the air as clean as possible, keeping sick people away.
Okay.
There's nothing much preventive as medication that you should need to give.
Hmm.
But standard hygiene practices should be good enough
okay.
to get you through this weather.
So Dr. Parekh, to wrap up this episode, you know, two very quick questions. Sleep regression, which is every mother's nightmare. How do you deal with that? And also teething.
So basically what you need to remember, what is normal and what is not. I mean, bringing up a child is not easy, but it's no rocket science. It just takes a lot of patience from the mother, especially the testing times,
right.
like phases of sleep regression. They can start as early as 2 months of age.
Right.
At 2 months, it can happen. It can happen again at 6 months, at 9 months, at 12 months, at 18 months. So the definition is there is a sudden change of sleep pattern.
Okay.
More awake than sleep. If sleepy, very irritable and cranky. So all the mehnat, the hard work that you've done in setting up a cycle just goes off
the
roof.
Window.
Yes,
absolutely.
So at that time, and these regression episodes can last anywhere between a month to 2 months. They're phases, but they're definitely going to end.
Okay.
But what the mother needs to know, what are the primary causes, so she doesn't panic. First, whenever there are episodes or sudden onset of sleep regression, you need to rule out basic illnesses, because illnesses are the commonest causes why the changes in sleep pattern or feeding pattern or anything can happen.
Okay.
So you need to rule out illnesses. They're very common in our city. So keep a watch out for fever, coughs, colds, vomiting or loose motions. If that's the cause, then you're not into regression yet. That's the cause of lack of sleep. If that's ruled out, then any milestone, achieving significant milestone, can put the baby in the regression phase for a few days to a week or even up to a month. Starting the weaning diet can cause sleep regression.
Okay.
Just starting to crawl can cause sleep regression. Just starting to walk can cause sleep regression.
Okay.
At 6 months, 7 months, the stranger anxiety setting in, recognizing people who are family and some strangers outside, can cause sleep regression.
Okay.
The first trip out to a birthday party, seeing hundreds of faces all of a sudden, can cause sleep regression.
So there are a lot of trigger points, clearly.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Tremendous amount of trigger
and
points.
And teething also, I guess, triggers.
So basically, the concept of teething is, it starts by 4-5 months, the hardening of the gums, you know. It makes them very irritable. I mean, you're in the phase where your baby's going through that
right now.
Absolutely.
She stops sleeping completely.
Absolutely. So the gums become hard, become extremely itchy. So they touch everything and put in their mouth. They shove their fist right inside, sometimes even more so to induce a vomit.
Yes.
Absolutely normal. Drooling, spit bubbles, spit all over the place. That's the only thing. But there's a myth buster. It doesn't cause fever.
Okay.
It doesn't cause cough. It doesn't cause loose motions. Basic science behind it, when it's teething, it's itchy. So they put everything in the mouth. And they put everything in the mouth, no matter how much cleanliness you keep around and hygiene, some infection. Yeah. Is bound to
There's
go
only
in.
So much you can control, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. So that's what it is. But yeah. Sleep regression always requires, is more a test for the mother than for the baby.
True.
Definitely.
So it is just a matter of time till it settles down on its own.
I'm going to keep that in mind because I'm completely sleep deprived now.
Yeah, so it's just the phase. It's just the phase. Yes,
that's good to hear. So thank you so much, both of you, for joining us here today. I think the key lesson that I at least took away that is that, you know, there's no right way or wrong way to be a parent. There's only your way, which is obviously the best way for the mother and the child. And of course, you know, there you have it. If you're watching this, you must know that there's no right way or wrong way. There's only your way. So trust your way. Thanks for watching.